I'm going to be ministering this morning on what I call the benefits of a joyful heart. How many know it's better to be happy than sad? It's better to be glad than mad. It's better to be all those positive things than all the negative things. And there are so many negative things in the world today and in our own lives. If you stop to think about it, it'll take you down pretty quick. But instead of focusing on that, even though you have to be aware of those things, because you can't deny reality. I mean, stuff is in the world. You have to deal with it. I mean, you got to deal with stuff. You can't just stick your head in the sand like an ostrich and pretend it ain't there. No, you got to deal with it. But at the same time, you must focus on the Lord, the promises of God, and the joy of the Lord that is your what? Your strength. So I want to talk about that this morning, and I got some funny things I'll share as I go through this, because God does want us to enjoy the life that He has given us. I read a story about a man once who went to a psychiatrist, and he said, "Doc, I've got two problems." And the psychiatrist said, "Okay, well, they'll tell me all about it." And so the man began, "Well, I think I'm a Pepsi machine." The doctor had never heard that before. That kind of took him back for a little bit. So he decided, he talked to him. He gave all of his little things that he helps people with psychologically, and nothing seemed to work. And finally, he got so exaggerated at the end of the session, the doctor jumped to his feet, grabbed a couple quarters, grabbed the guy, shoved him down his mouth, shook him until he swallowed him, and he said, "Okay, if you're a drink machine, give me a Pepsi." And the man said, "Well," he said, "Doc, that's my second problem. I'm out of order. I can't do it." How many know that sometimes life can make you feel out of order? Things can happen in life that even though you may be going along fine, if you feel like all of a sudden I'm out of order. But I want to tell you this morning, Jesus is the one that can put us back in order again. And He knows how to fix us. He created us. He can heal the heart. He can heal the body. Thank God He can heal the mind, because where would we be, some of us, right now if He wasn't the healer of the mind? But God is the one that can put us back in order again. I want to start by just reading one proverb and make a few opening comments, and that's Proverbs 13:9. Most of them will be in the PowerPoint, but you're welcome to turn in your Bibles also. But the Bible says, "The light of the righteous rejoices, but the lamp of the wicked will be put out." It's a very short, concise proverb, and a lot of what I'm going to be preaching today comes out of the Proverbs, and the Proverbs are simply nuggets of wisdom that God gave to King Solomon that he wrote down that became part of the Word of God. How many know that God knows what's best, and His Word contains the wisdom? And so the Proverbs are actually nuggets of wisdom. This little verse has significant meaning for anybody that'll kind of take note of what it says there, and it mentions how the light of the righteous will do what? It rejoices. And that word light there is mentioned, it's kind of used as a metaphor to refer to a person's happiness and prosperity in life. How many of you want to be happy and prosperous? All right? So when he's using light in that particular verse, it's talking about your life and your prosperity, your happiness in life, what everybody really wants in that. He says, this light of the righteous is something that rejoices. I believe God wants His people to rejoice. And the wisdom of this proverb is telling us that people who live in righteousness, people who live for God, people who do what is right and have lives that are filled with the Lord will have lives that are also filled with joy and rejoicing. That's what the promise of God's Word is. Why? Because the happiness and the joy that we receive comes from the Lord. Now, there is some joy and happiness that the world can give, but how do you know that's temporary? The joy and happiness that God gives is eternal. It'll sustain you even through the hard, difficult, dark, gloomy, droomy days of this life, because Jesus gives us that type of a joy. But on the opposite side of it, that proverb simply says this also, that the lamp or the enjoyment of those who live in sin, he says what? It's going to be put out. In the old days, they used lamps. I used to use lamps. I haven't used a lamp in a long time now, but even when the power went off, sometimes I had oil lamps I'd used to light up, and got a generator now, so I just flip the switch on the generator and, I get light in the house. But in the old days, when you lit a lamp, eventually that lamp would go out. Why? Because it would run out of oil. It would run out of fuel. It would eventually go out, and even to refill it, you typically had to put it out to put more in it. And that's what God's warning is to the wicked, those who live in sin, those who will not serve God. He said, you may have some enjoyment right now. There is pleasure in sin for a season. But eventually your light will be put out and it will go away. We need to realize that we need to live for God. Because the light of the righteous is rejoicing. Because Jesus is the light. And he's the eternal light. He's the eternal joy. We have Jesus and we have the light of the world. And that all means that the joy that we have is something that is a blessing. It's a benefit to the people of God. How many of you want more of that joy this morning? So let's talk about the benefits of a joyful heart. There are benefits to having a joyful heart while we live in this world. There is a happiness and a joy that God gives to his people. So let's see what the Bible says about it to remind us of this, because we have to be reminded of this. Life pushes us down, but the Lord will lift us up. So let's look at what God's word says. First, I want to go to Proverbs 4, verse 23. Proverbs 4, 23 simply says this: keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are what? The issues of life. It's a very simple, succinct proverb, but in that proverb, he gives us some wisdom to realize the importance of what sustains us in this life. How many know that your heart is a very important organ in your body? If your heart stops, guess what? You stop. It's just common sense. So the heart is a very important organ. But not only is it the physical heart, but I believe Solomon, as the Word of God is speaking this here, also has in mind our spiritual heart, that spiritual part of us. And he says something significant: guard your heart, keep your heart. That word keep there means to guard, to protect, to watch your heart. Why? Because out of your heart proceeds the issues of life. Just as your physical heart pumps blood through your body, and that blood is the life of your body and sustains life in your body, so too your heart, your spirit, is what sustains you spiritually, and out of that goes the spiritual life that you live and enjoy with the Lord. So you have to protect that. You have to guard that. How many of you ever heard the saying, garbage in, garbage out? If you allow things in your heart that should not be there, then it will affect you. It will pull you down. It will destroy your spiritual life, and that will also affect your physical life. It's amazing how spiritual things also affect us in the physical realm. They're kind of tied together. The spiritual will affect the physical. The psychological and the mental are affected also by the spiritual. That in turn will affect you physically. So everything that we're talking about this morning helps us on all levels. Turn to your neighbor and say, I need help on all levels. All of us need that. We need God's word. So guard your heart. Watch what you think. So many times Christians are defeated because they begin to think certain ways and they fill their minds with certain thought processes, and those negative ways of thinking only lend to destroy them and harm them, and it robs us of our faith. How many of you got to have faith with God? And you got to walk in faith. You got to maintain faith. So it's careful. Be careful what you allow in your heart, because in your heart that also kind of includes the mind and your thought processes. How many know the battle is won or lost up here? The battle quite often is won or lost up here. And that's why there's a war going on. And sometimes the devil will put thoughts in your mind. He can do that. He can somehow drop suggestions inside of you, insert little thoughts. And you have a choice at that moment. You can cast down that thought and that vain imagination, and you can replace it with something that God has, or you can dwell on that thought. And if you dwell on that thought, then guess what? It's going to get bigger. And it's going to occupy your whole mind, and then it's going to start weighing you down. It'll affect your heart, and it'll drag your spirit down. And guess what? That ain't good for you. So we've got to learn to get the victory inside of our hearts and inside of our minds. Be careful not to allow negative things like depression or fear or worry or anxiety. Stay in your heart. Guard your heart against that. When you see these things beginning to creep in, you do what is necessary to get out of that. Spiritually, I want to encourage you, turn to the Word of God. Begin reading God's Word. I mean, you know, there are plenty of promises of God in here that'll encourage you and lift you up and bless you and strengthen you and edify you. You got to fill your mind with that. But there's also some practical things to do. The problem is many people just turn to the practical stuff, but you got to have God's word as the most important thing. But hey, sometimes you just need to go out and do something fun. Go do something fun, enjoyable. Have that release so that you can enjoy the blessings of God, and combine that most of all with the Word of God. And through prayer, guess what? The Holy Spirit will bring joy into your life. You got to have things that you enjoy in life. Sometimes Christians get so stuffy that we forget that God wants us to enjoy life. He wants you to have fun. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's okay to have fun. It is. If it's good, wholesome fun, okay? Let me tell you, the world has a lot of fun stuff that's not good, that's sinful, that's wicked. That's not what I'm talking about. But God created this world for us. If you, those of you who have been in our Wednesday night Bible studies last year, when God created the earth, who did he give it to? Man. He gave man dominion over the earth. God made the world, and I believe behind giving him dominion over the earth, God actually created it for man that he created and placed on it and gave the rulership over it. So this world is meant for us and our enjoyment. And that's a wonderful blessing that I think God wants us to know. Problem is, we screwed it up pretty good with our sin, rebellion, and all that type of stuff that's out there. But we have to be careful not to allow these things to weigh us down. I've read this story before, but I like it. Some of you probably haven't heard it. But there was a boy once who went to a grocery store, and he asked for a box of Dove detergent. And the grocer was a little puzzled because boys don't typically go in the store to buy, you know, laundry detergent. And so he said, "Young man, what do you want it for?" And he said, "I want to wash my cat with it." And the grocer immediately tried to discourage him. "Son, you're not supposed to wash a cat with laundry detergent. You can't wash his cat." But the boy insisted it'd be okay, and so he went ahead. And a few days later, the boy returned, and so the grocer was curious. He asked him, said, what happened to your cat? And the boy said, "Oh, he died." And the grocer responded to him. He said, "Well, son, I warned you not to wash your cat with Dove detergent." And the boy said, "Oh, the soap didn't hurt him a bit. It was the spin cycle that got him." How many of you feel like you're in a spin cycle at times of life? We're worried about one thing getting us, but it's the spin cycle of life sometimes that we get stuck in that does us in. Good news is Jesus knows how to get us out of that. And he can clean our lives up without the does and without the spin cycle. God, by his power, can do in us what we need. You know, we have to allow these things not to weigh us down. Guard your heart. Another proverb I want to mention to you tonight, this morning, is Proverbs 14, verse 30. This proverb simply says, "A sound heart is the life of the flesh, but envy is the rottenness of the bones." A sound heart is the life of the flesh, but envy, it's rottenness inside the bones. What is he simply saying to us there? Negative emotions like bitterness, envy is the main one he mentioned, but I believe you can apply this to all those negative type emotions that sometimes people get caught up in because life does something or someone does something and instantly we react with these negative things. You know, that's a natural reaction. The problem is you cannot allow those negative things to remain in you and to captivate you and to motivate you and control you. You have to control them. So if you allow bitterness and envy and strife and malice and all those types of things and resentment to build up in your heart and you don't get rid of them overnight, how many know the Bible says, "Do not let the sun go down on your wrath"? If you are mad or upset at someone or something, you need to get over it before you go to bed. You need to forgive them. You need to let go of it. You need to put it out of your heart. You got to guard your heart, because if you don't, that anger will turn to resentment, bitterness, and hatred by the next morning. If that's the thing that's on your mind the next morning, then guess what? You didn't obey the word of God and get rid of it before you went to bed. The first thing that should be on your mind should be something of the Lord, either a scripture verse or a praise song, because you're filling your heart and mind with that. So kind of keep that in mind. Science has proven these things, these negative type emotions, will also not only affect your spiritual life, they'll affect your health. If you allow these negative things to be inside of you, resentment, rage, malice, anger, you know, all these types of things, it will affect you physically. Why? Because science has proven that it somehow zaps your immune system. And when your immune system gets low and is zapped by these emotions that drain the whatever out of your body, then guess what? You're susceptible to catch whatever comes along. And so we just need to learn it's better for us to obey God's word and get rid of these negative things. Now, I want to stress to you, these negative things happen to us because we live in a sin-filled world. You can't control what other people say to you. You can't stop what other people sometimes do to you. So you have to learn to react in a better way. And by reacting in a better way, when you see these negative responses coming up inside of you, you got to deal with them right then and get over it. I mean, the quicker you get over it, the better off we are. It's spiritually, physically, emotionally, and all those things. Those who have a sound heart, and that word sound means a wholesome, a healthy heart. If you've got a wholesome and healthy heart, how many know that your body does well? But if you've got a heart that's got some issues, it pulls everything down. Same thing spiritually. If you are spiritually whole and have a healthy heart spiritually, how many know that you'll be at peace with God, with other people, and with yourself. There's too many people walking around today in this world that are Christians that are just not at peace even with themselves. How many know that God wants you to be at peace in your heart and inside of your mind? So you got to get rid of this stuff. Proverbs 15, verse 13 is another proverb. Many of you have read it before. It says, a merry heart doeth or maketh a cheerful countenance, but by sorrow of the heart, the spirit is broken. King James Version says, a merry heart makes a cheerful countenance. That's pretty logical. If you have a happy heart, guess what? It shows up on your face. I mean, you know that the heart sometimes, you know, is different from what people portray, but eventually what is on the face comes from the heart. We need to realize that sorrow and grief are a natural part of life. It's not wrong that you experience these things because it happens to us. We live in a world that is affected by sin and death. So sorrow and grief are part of life's processes. Matter of fact, God created us with the ability to grieve as a way to deal with that. I've heard some people preach and teach that grief is a bad thing. No, it's not. Grief in itself, God created you with that capacity. And if God created you with the capacity to grieve, then it's not bad. What's bad about it is if you stay in it. Because what is grief? Grief is your mind and your body, but it's the mental process and emotional process that you go through to deal with the bad stuff that just happened to you so that you can then go on with the rest of your life and live a happy, productive life. You face it, you deal with it, you accept it, you come to terms with it, and you're overcome with God's grace and God's help, and you then put the grief behind you. But it's a process that you go through, and how many know everybody goes through that process? You just don't want to get stuck in it. That's the issue. When people get stuck somewhere along that grieving process, then different things start to fall apart and they get trapped in that. And that's when the devil starts to mess with them because God doesn't want you to stay in the grief. He wants you to rise above it. He wants you to gain the victory. And I'm glad that God gives us the joy that we need. So when we experience types of sorrow in our life, you need to turn to the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit comfort your heart. Let the Holy Spirit heal your heart. Let the Holy Spirit strengthen you and give you the joy that you need. Jesus promised to give us a joy, but you got to claim that joy. You got to claim that joy. Proverbs 15, verse 15 says this, all the days of the afflicted are evil, but he that is of a merry heart has a continual feast. Those who are afflicted and going through difficult times, that's bad. But God's people, if you have a merry heart, it's like a continual feast. It's like a never-ending Wednesday night Bible study that we have now, where we're eating all the time. We're going to have to do something about that gain weight, though. But, this is a simple proverb, and it's true. I read a story about a kindergarten teacher once who had a birthday. And so all the students, somehow parents arranged that they would surprise their kindergarten teacher. And so they all bought gifts to the teacher. The first student, whose parents owned a flower shop, gave her a present. She held it, and she said, I guess it's flowers. And the little boy said, how did you guess? And she laughed, and she thanked him for it. The second student, whose parents owned a candy store, gave him her present, and she held it and said, I believe it's probably some candy in here. And the boy said, how did you guess? And she laughed, and she thanked him for the gift too. The third student, whose parents owned a wine shop, gave her a box, and the box was leaking. The teacher touched the liquid and then tasted it and said, is it wine? And the little girl said, no. The teacher was a little puzzled this time, so she touched the leaky spot again and tasted it. Is it champagne? And the little girl said, no, it's a puppy. Surprise, surprise, surprise. How many know that life sometimes hits you with things that you're just not aware of, and that's not the continual feast you want. But we want a feast that we can enjoy, that we can get something out of, and not something that, turns your stomach there. But this proverb simply is telling us, as what I'm sharing here, there is a person, if you have a merry heart, a happy heart, it's like you'll have a continual feast, even in the midst of your afflictions. Even in the midst of your hard times, even in the midst of your trials and difficulties, because we all have them. Even in the midst of it, though, God says, if you have a merry heart, you'll have a continual feast. Well, you'll be feasting on the Lord and the promises of God and the Word of God, and it'll sustain you, it'll strengthen you, it'll carry you, it'll give you, it'll build your faith, and you'll overcome the afflictions and you'll sail above it. But you've got to maintain that merry heart. You know, there's other scriptures, and one of them says the spirit of a man will sustain him as in his infirmity. It's one of Solomon's words of wisdom there, that our spirit will somehow sustain us even when we're sick, even in our infirmity. But how many know if your spirit is not lifted up, then it's not going to sustain you in the midst of all that. Someone with a merry heart, I believe, is able to receive the promises of God more effectively and to apply them to their life. And a merry heart allows faith to operate through us so we can believe God for the things that we need and for the healing that we need. So maintain a merry heart. You say, well, Pastor, I don't feel merry. Well, we're going to talk about that in a few moments. But you got to be having a merry heart. Proverbs 17:22 is probably a very familiar passage of Scripture. It simply says this, a merry heart doeth good like a what? Medicine. Did you take your medicine this morning? Just because you come to church don't mean you're supposed to skip reading your Bible. All right? You need to take some medicine before you get here. He says, but a broken spirit does what? Dryeth the bones. A merry heart does like a medicine. Now, those of you who are my age and older, you know, when I was a child and you had to take medicine, it tasted nasty. We had two flavors back then. We had cherry and grape. I still have nightmares of the way that they could take a beautiful taste like cherry and turn it into something that is just, to this day, traumatizes me whenever I smell that. I mean, it's just, kids today have any flavor they want to pick when they go to the pharmacy. I mean, you want bubblegum flavored, and it actually tastes pretty good. I mean, it's just amazing. But in my day, and some of you are much older than me, you only had one thing, and that was castor oil. How would you like to go back to them days? No, thank you. But, you know, Mary Hardy says it's like a medicine. It does us really good. There was an owner of a drugstore once who, you know, walked outside and he found a guy leaning heavily against a wall. This guy just looked terrible. And so the owner of the pharmacy went in and asked his young guy behind the counter, he said, what's up with that guy out there by the wall on the outside? And the clerk said, well, he came in here this morning to get something for his cough, and I couldn't find any cough syrup, so I gave him an entire bottle of laxative. The owner just got really mad at that point. He said, you idiot, you can't treat a cough medicine with a whole bottle of laxative. And the clerk very calmly said, of course you can. Just look at him. He's afraid to cough. Some of you will get that one in a few minutes, I guess. A merry heart does like a medicine. Not like that medicine, but a lot more effective. Because how many know that God's word has what you need for what you're going through? You got to treat the symptoms with the right thing to get the right result. And so God's word will do that for us. It works like a medicine in our life. It heals the heart. It heals the soul. And there's power in the word of God that will even bring healing to our bodies. How many believe that the word of God is a healing power in itself? I've had testimonies, and I've got some testimonies on a CD. I think I gave it out to someone, just of healing scriptures that people have just with deathly, you know, prognosis is by doctors, given up, no hope at all, just simply played scriptures over and over again and were healed by simply listening to the word of God. True stories. So there's power in God's word. Proverbs 13 verse 12 says, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but when desire comes, it's a tree of life. That's a very simple proverb. You know, sometimes things don't always go as planned. You know, we don't always get everything we want. We have hopes, we have dreams, and sometimes your little hopes and your dreams just get dashed on the rocks. It just doesn't happen the way you want, you know, and our hopes are deferred, and you know, that kind of depresses you. That pulls you down because you had all your hopes on something and then it didn't happen. How many know, instead of having your hopes on something in this world, you've got to ultimately have your hope in Jesus, because he's always going to be there for you. Things will happen like this that affect us, that pull us. But you know what? Your attitude is the main thing in all of that as to how it's going to ultimately affect you. I've shared this before, but again, it's a good story to remind us of this. There's a family with two twin boys once. I mean, they were almost identical in their looks, but the problem was they were totally different in their personalities. If one felt it was too hot, the other thought it was too cold. If one said the TV was too loud, the other said the TV was too soft and needed to be turned up. They were opposite in every way. One was an eternal optimist and the other was just a gloomy pessimist. So to see what would happen once, they had a birthday and their dad decided to load the pessimist's room with every type of imaginable toy and game that he could want. I mean, he just bought him everything. And then in the optimist child's room, he put a pile of horse manure 5 feet deep. And that night, the father went by and he passed by the pessimist boy's room and found him just sitting amid all those new toys crying. And so he asked him, he said, "Why are you crying?" He said, "Because my friends are going to be jealous. I'll have to read all the instructions before I can do anything with all this stuff. I'll need batteries all the time. They're going to eventually get broken. And it's just, he was just freaking out because he had all these new problems to deal with." So then he decided to go check on the optimist twins' room. And he found this boy in a pile of manure dancing for jumping up and down and just, you know, slinging manure everywhere, looking through it. And he said, "Why are you so happy?" He said, "There's got to be a pony in here somewhere." It's really the outlook. It's the attitude. What are you going to do with what you're going through? It makes a difference with this. You know, hope deferred makes a heart sick. We've got to hold on to that hope, especially if it is a hope that is reasonable and one that God gives us. And we maintain that. But I want to always encourage you, ultimately put your hopes in God. Because you're not going to get everything that you always want in life. I wish I could stand here and tell you that you'll get everything that you ever want. But you won't. That's biblical. You know. And sometimes God will even deny some things to us just to teach us a lesson so that we'll grow in maturity. But ultimately, he does bless us with many of the hopes and dreams that we want. And so we thank God for that. But at the same time, you know, there's a balance. We have an enemy that will rob, steal, kill, and mess things up. So ultimately, your hope has to be in Jesus and looking to God and trusting in him and staying faithful to him through all those things. So let me just talk about one other thing, another aspect of this. There are some things that we need to do to maintain a joyful heart. What I've shared with you are just some scriptures that talk about what a joyful heart does for us. But what do we do to maintain it? If I've convinced you that you need this, well, how do you hold on to this joyful heart? How do you keep it? I'm glad you asked, because the Bible tells us how to maintain a joyful heart. First of all, we come to Proverbs 12, verse 18. And that verse simply says this: "Some people make cutting remarks, but the words of the wise bring healing." King James Version translates it this way: "There is one who speaks like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise promotes health." In other words, we need to realize that there are some people in this world that will speak things that destroy and kill and hurt, but there are others who speak things that are positive, uplifting, and a blessing into our lives. You know, I read about some buffalo once that were grazing out on the range, and a tourist popped by and looked at him and said out loud, "Those are the mangiest, scroungiest, ugliest beasts I've ever seen." One of the buffalo turned to the other one and said, "You know, I think I just heard a discouraging word." Out on the range. Some people will sorry about that. I like that one. Yeah. Have you ever heard a discouraging word from somebody that just really took you down? I mean, you could be having the nicest day of your life. You could be out there just grazing away and just having a good old time, and a discouraging word will pop your bubble if you let it. Okay? You don't have to let that discouraging word affect you, but you have to recognize this. So how do we maintain a joyful heart? Well, sometimes you have to recognize the effects of other people and what they say, and sometimes you just have to avoid being around some people. You can't isolate yourself completely. Don't misunderstand me. But there are just some people sometimes that you can only take so much of. Bless their little hearts. Before the spirit of slap comes on you, and then you got to pray through again or whatever. So then that's just some wisdom. So you need to minister to them. They need help to get out of the mess they're in. But you have to also use wisdom. There's only so much you can do. And so sometimes you need to give some space and you need to stay away from that, because if it's bringing you down, you don't need that. You need to focus on God so that you can build yourself up to where you can go help them eventually. And I've seen people take this to an extreme. I've seen some people just cut others off completely in their life, and That's not good either. Like I said, they need help. How many know that God wants you eventually to become the person that can even maybe help them? So balance that out. But sometimes you do. You need to not answer their calls or whatever. You need to, you know, give some space because their words will just hurt, destroy, and pull you down. And you need to avoid that. But I want to also encourage you, when it comes to conflict, sometimes you need to learn how to deal with the conflict by confronting the people. And that's not a pleasant thing. But what did Jesus say? If someone offends you, you go talk to them. You work it out. The problem is most Christians never do that today. Most Christians today, if someone offends them, hurts their feelings, they just ignore it and hopes it never gets any worse. And guess what? Ignoring it does not fix it. It gets worse. In different ways, it gets worse. And that's why Jesus says you go talk to them and you work this out and they apologize and you come together in agreement. Why? Because when you confront someone, if they're a Christian especially, then guess what? It teaches them a lesson. They can't run around saying that like that anymore. And hopefully they'll get the message and God will convict them to the point where they'll stop doing that. Because, honey, if they're doing it to you, they're doing it to other people. Do you understand that? And so if you don't care how it hurts you, then that's okay. But you need to be concerned about everybody else that they're messing up. And so out of love, you see, that's what the real thing of love does. I love you so much, I want to see you change and get better and stop doing this to other people in your life. And so let me talk to you about this. I forgive you, but let's change this. And how many know some people are totally blind to some of these types of issues they have? They don't even realize it. And until someone in love confronts them in a love, okay, there has to be a love. You can't just get out of them and cuss them out, all right, or yell at them, whatever. That ain't going to work. But in love, go to them and say, yeah, I love you, but you know this hurt or whatever. Can you know, how many know that God can take that and begin to change them? You know what? There's power in prayer when you do that. Because Jesus said, if two of you agree as touching anything, it'll be done. You know what the context of that verse and that promise is? It's right after he told people that have a conflict with one another to make it up, to come together in agreement. And when you do that, he says, you can then pray with them and you'll see miracles happen. Why? Because you've gotten rid of the sin. You've gotten rid of the stuff that hinders the miracle power of God from flowing in our prayers. How many know that we need to keep things right between us and the Lord? Because this world needs the power of God, needs the miracles of God, it needs all that. There's another verse I want to read to you, John 13, verse 17. Jesus said this, if you know these things, happy are you if you do them. Now, the context that's going on here is Jesus has just done something that just shocked the disciples. He took a towel and took some water and washed their dirty, stinking feet. And when I say dirty, stinking feet, I mean dirty, stinking feet. We today have no idea what life was like back then, because when you went walking out, you walked everywhere mostly, unless you had money and you rode a horse or a donkey. But for people that walking, and so guess what? They didn't have the nice, lovely roads that we have today. They had roads, but they were traveled upon with donkeys and cattle and horses. And guess what? There was stuff left behind. So guess what you walked through? And you had open-toed sandals is what they wore back then. So no matter where you walked, in a city or out in the country, you're stepping in it every step of the way. And so the custom in their day was when you enter someone's home, ladies, how much you do not like somebody tracking in poo-poo in your house? And so the custom of their day was before you entered into their house, the owner would wash your feet. Or his servant actually would. That was a servant's job, a slave's job. And what does Jesus do here? He takes his disciples and he humbles himself and he washes the stuff off of their feet. And he tells them, what I've done, you do also. In other words, humble yourself and be willing to serve other people out of love. Do what is necessary to help them to get rid of the stuff that's in their life. And that means you have to humble yourself to serve them instead of being the person that is always being the one that's served. But I found this out. If you do what God wants, how many know that you're ultimately truly happy? So how do you maintain the joy? You serve God out of love and faithfulness. And it may be hard at times. It may be difficult at times. And you may not even get thanked or recognized at times. But if you will serve God, he will fill your heart with a joy. And God will minister to you. Romans 14, verse 22, Paul goes on to say this. And it's a powerful verse. He says, Do you have faith? Have it to yourself before God. Happy is he who does not condemn himself in what he approves. Paul's telling us there that there is a happiness that comes, but it will be short-circuited in our lives if we are feeling guilty or not right with God. How many know if your heart is not right with God, it'll mess up the joy that you have with the Lord? We need to be people that are joyful, that serve God, that maintain a clear conscience. So if you sin, you repent, you ask God to forgive you, and then you receive his joy. Because if you don't, you know what the devil tries to do? He tries to heap condemnation on you and make you feel so bad and guilty that you throw in the towel and quit. Don't ever do that. How many know that if God forgives you, you need to forgive yourself and then rejoice and be happy. Learn the lesson, but rejoice and be happy, because great is your forgiveness. Philippians 4, verse 4. I preached on this quite often. It's a verse I will refer to many times, but the Bible simply says this: rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. That verse is the key to a successful Christian life. Paul wrote this as a command. He said, rejoice. That's a command. That tells me that even though you don't feel happy, even though you don't feel good, you have to choose to be happy. It's your attitude. It's a choice of your will. You may have got up this morning and you felt like, wah. But you have a choice at that moment. I can continue feeling like, wah. Or I can choose to rejoice in the Lord, and I can choose to be happy, because my attitude is not determined by my circumstances or by what I feel or what's being done to me. My attitude is my choice, and I will choose to rejoice in the Lord my God. That is what you have to do. And I know it's tough, because I have to do this too. There are times where, you know, things happen and everything just goes wrong and you just really want to just pack up the car and just go to Australia or something. I mean, it's just, yeah, but you have to stop in the midst of that and say, I will rejoice in the Lord my God. Whether you want to rejoice with me or not, I'm going to be happy in the Lord. David had to encourage himself in the Lord once. He was out there all by himself being hunted like a dog, and you know, he didn't have anybody to pep him up, so he said, I have to encourage myself in the Lord here. You got to have church with yourself and, you know, praise the Lord, start singing praises to God, giving thanks to God. And it's amazing when we do that, the change that happens in the spiritual realm around us. That'll even affect us physically in other ways. You can't control what other people do. You can't control your circumstances around you all the times, but you can control what you think. And you can control your attitude. I know it's difficult. And when you do that, you can then control how you react. See, that's the thing that gets us in trouble, is how we react. If you react properly, it keeps you from sinning. But if you react improperly, you sin or you make it worse. And how many know we're all experts at making things worse? Seems like. So if I can control that thought process, is I can then control how I react and not be dictated by my feelings. Your feelings come and go. But how many know the Word of God is the same? So if you put the Word in you and let that be the guide, I think it'll do something for you. Paul also, in the next few verses, he mentions that you need to pray always. How many know that you need to take your worries and anxieties to the Lord in prayer? And he said, do so with thanksgiving. It's amazing when you start giving thanks to God, how it helps change your attitude in the midst of all the different stuff that you're going through and what's taking place. I read a story about a little boy once. His name was Mike, and his parents overheard him praying. He said, now I lay me down to rest, and I hope to pass tomorrow's test. If I should die before I wake, well, that's one less test I have to take. Have you ever felt like that in life sometimes? You like to skip some of those tests. Well, sometimes you can, but sometimes you can't, so you got to control the way you go through it. I know I've gone over here, but got a couple more scriptures I want to give you, and then I'll close. Psalm 9, verse 2. This is what the psalmist wrote, and he said, I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praises to your name, O thou most high. I will rejoice and sing praises to you. Why? That's a choice. So one of the ways that you maintain your joy and receive the benefits continually in your life is you be a praiser. You need to be a praiser. You say, well, Pastor, I can't sing that well. I don't care how good or bad you sing. You just need to praise him. Don't let no rock take your place. You may have to pass out earplugs to other people around you, but you praise the Lord. We have some out there in the foyer you can take home to give away to people. No, I'm just joking with you. But you need to be a person that rejoices, that praises God. And you say, well, other people will think I'm nuts. Who cares what other people think? And they will. I've been going down the road sometimes just singing praise songs. You pull up to a stoplight and I've got it blasting and they've got their stuff blasting. I might as well blast my stuff. And I'm just sitting there praising Jesus and they're looking at me like, what are you doing? I'm praising the Lord. How are you doing? Yeah, be a testimony. They think we're nuts anyway. Just give them some more fodder. Be a fool for Christ. But if they'll see your joy that you've got in the midst of it, they'll realize there's something to that. See, that's the problem. Too many Christians today aren't really showing the joy of the Lord. Why would anybody want what we've got if we don't enjoy it either? I mean, we got too many people walking around looking like they've been baptized in pickle juice. Rejoice and be happy in the Lord. You know, praising is something that does it. And then Jesus said this, John 14, verse 1, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. You say, Pastor, why do you end this message with that sermon? Because Jesus tells us there, don't let your heart be overweighed with troubles, anxieties, and things that happen in life. There's something better that God has in store for us. We need to realize that God does have a blessing for his people. God does have things for us, but we've got to be the people that seek him, that receive from him. The first step to having a happy heart is a relationship with God who made the heart. And how many know if God made the heart, he can be the healer and the sustainer and the joy giver for our hearts through this life. So that means I've always got to have faith. That's why Jesus challenged his own disciples. He said, you believe in God, believe in me. Have faith and believe in him, because there are benefits to having this joyful heart. There are benefits and blessings to walking in the joy of the Lord. And it is something that God will give you, but you have to claim it for yourself or the devil will steal it from you. Don't let the devil take your joy. Don't let the devil take your blessing. You hold on to it and you say, God, I'm going to rejoice in you. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's pray this morning.